Hello. Welcome to the Billy Wilder Theater. I'm Claudia Bester. I'm the Director of Public Programs here at the Hammer Museum. I'm very pleased to introduce tonight's talk by Michael Lejeune. First of all, I should explain that the program has two distinct agendas. At least I have two distinct agendas. One is to talk about graphic design and the great work of Michael Lejeune and his team. But we're also here to talk about public transportation, and more specifically, public transportation in Los Angeles, a city where many people who live here and people who don't live here and like to make fun of us sometimes, think that there's no public transportation, or they used to think so, and persuading them otherwise is the work of Michael Lejeune and the Metro Creative Services Department. But before we get to that, I do want to say that Los Angeles is really entering a golden era of public transportation. Our light rails are expanding, our buses are state of the art with these little GPS sensors that can tell you exactly when your bus is going to come, so you don't have to be kept in the dark. And they have computers that can even change red lights into green lights on certain lines. And biking, which is very dear to my heart, with the help of the mayor and popular support generated by the LA County Bicycle Coalition and Ciclavia, and we hope a little bit by the Hammer's annual bike night, the city's now sprouting new bike lanes all over the place, and biking or combining bike with metro has finally become a popular commuting option. So before I bring Michael to the stage, I want to show you a brief film that the LA Mayor's Office created that kind of summarizes this trend. I should note that this clip is not from the Metro Creative Services Department. It's basically an infomercial, but it does get the point across. So please, let's roll that clip.
We had a great public transportation system in Southern California. We dismantled it in the 1940s and 50s.
LA is trying to cope with a history of being auto-dominated. We're approaching the end of the era of cheap fuel. We have a greenhouse gas problem. We have global warming. We have the congestion in the county.
In November of 2008, we passed, with a two-thirds vote, Measure R, a half-penny sales tax that will double the size of the rail system, make $40 billion of investments over a 30-year period of time in our public transportation system, our highways, our bridges, our roads.
We are living in the golden age of rapid transit infrastructure construction in this city of Los Angeles and the county of Los Angeles. No metropolitan area has had so many transit projects compressed into one short period of time as we are witnessing right now in Los Angeles. So pinch yourselves. We are the lucky ones who get to partake of this tremendous new amenity, this improvement to our quality of life.
There's no city in the country, none, that is building as much, expanding as much public transit as we are. And we're very excited about that.
We are experiencing the highest ridership since World War II on our rail lines. So great things are happening.
I'm meeting up with my husband after work, and he works near the Wilshire and Vermont station. So it was a convenient way for us to go and not have two cars out this evening.
This Gold Line extension really has added a whole bunch of excitement to this neighborhood. I take this train to Union Station, which goes on to USC, pretty much every day.
We've improved our service at night. That really just reflects the trend of LA towards becoming a 24-hour city. We are seeing a seismic shift in perceptions and attitudes about transit in Los Angeles.
I'm part of a new generation of Angelinos, you know, one that only has one car with four people in the household. You know, the lifestyle is different. You feel that the community is alive.
I couldn't be prouder of Angelinos who understand we can't keep this addiction going on single passenger automobiles. We have to have alternatives.
They made it easy with the metro. Now I can just check the schedule on my cell phone.
I like to take the bus, like for instance, to Chinatown to have lunch or something. Sometimes I use the B, LADOT's Dash Line. I usually go on my smartphone, and you can either use a text, phone, or type in the website, and it'll show you a real-time moving map where the bus is, how long it'll take to get to you, and it's really accurate, up to the minute. I sit in my office and I watch the bus come and I say, oh, it's down the street. I'm sure I can run down in time because I see it's right there and get to the signal and hop on the bus.
Every single bus is a clean fuel bus. It's the largest clean fuel fleet in the world.
We're very excited. We have brand new, clean air, comfortable, quiet new buses. We love them. I have ridden about 300,000 miles commuting back and forth over 20 years, and that's a savings I calculate of about 2 cars that I haven't had to buy.
We have synchronized nearly every traffic signal in the city. We can do things here no other city can do. We make the signals more efficient. That way people are not stopping and going, they keep on moving. We reduce congestion, we reduce pollution, and we're able to monitor and make adjustments if we have special events.
We're encouraging more folks to be on bikes, adding more than 1,600 new bike lanes on the streets, and celebrating with events like Ciclovia. 2 times per year, we close off about 10 miles of streets for Angelenos to bike, walk, skate, use all different types of non-motorized transportation.
I started riding my bike after the first time I went to Ciclovia. It was such a cool experience. I mean, I get the exercise, I'm outside, and it's one of those things where after work, I'm like, oh, I get to ride my bike home and kind of enjoy kind of that kid feeling again. I do feel a sense of relief when I get onto the bike lane. It does make a difference. You see a lot more bicyclists on the street and it makes you feel like you're a part of something.
I live here in North Hollywood and I go pretty much all over Southern California on mass transit, and I think it's great. With a little knowledge and a little know-how and the computer, you could plan a trip practically from North Hollywood, San Diego, even San Francisco.
That's what building out this system is all about. It's recreating the city, it's reestablishing LA as a great public transit city. It's remaking the city along transportation lines and stations, having places where people can work and shop and live all around those stations.
Last week, Congress passed the transportation bill, and tomorrow, the president will sign it. This bill invests $105 billion over the next 2 years and puts Americans back to work, paving roads, lane track, and building bridges across the country. And importantly for LA, this bill also funds America Fast Forward.
We are going to see 2 million jobs saved and 1 million new jobs created.
Yeah.
And America Fast Forward had its beginnings right here in California, in Los Angeles.
With America Fast Forward and this surface transportation bill, we're gonna be able to accelerate 30 years of funding in a 10-year period of time.
We will be able to accelerate the remaining projects that are on the Measure R list and do them all in this decade, which will put people to work and get people out of their cars.
And we've already had a down payment on that effort. We're putting up the money. We're loaning from the federal government to be able to accelerate our programs now and paying them back. We're headed in the right direction. But this is only the beginning. I don't want anyone to think just about what we've accomplished. I want you to imagine how much more that we could do together.
All right, I want to add to that my own plug that when the Expo line opened last May, going from downtown LA to Culver City, I sold my car and I've been very happily using the bus, the Expo line, and my scooter. And I haven't missed my car at all, and I'm saving around $500 a month. So if that isn't enough financial incentive to use public transportation or bicycles, thank you. You should know that Metro passes are often subsidized by workplaces, like here at UCLA, where I think they cover about half the cost of buying a Metro pass, and the VA and other workplaces. And your Metro card can get you great discounts, like $5 off admission here at the Hammer Museum. Also, tonight only, you can show your Metro Tap card to any member of our staff and get entered in a raffle to win our beautiful Graphic Design Now catalog that goes along with the exhibit upstairs, and also to win one of our street banners for this exhibition. More importantly than all the great financial incentives, it's good for clean air. It's way more low stress than driving. You get to read. And for me, I get that sense of community and interaction that you get in great cities like New York and London and Paris. This is gonna sound sappy, I'm sorry, but it's true. It's like all different human beings all together breathing the same air. and interacting with each other, and it's a collective experience. And you know what they say about culture. Culture is shared experience. So I would say that Metro riders are very cultured people. Needless to say, I'm a huge fan of LA Metro. So how do we convince other fellow Angelenos that public transportation is the way to go? This brings us to one of the larger questions that our whole exhibition asks, which is, can good design promote social change? I think that our guest speaker would say yes, and his work sets a great example for how that can happen. Michael Lejeune is the creative director for the Los Angeles County Metropolitan Transportation Authority, aka Metro. He oversees the Metro's 30-person creative services group, which designs everything from the advertising to wayfinding and signage, bus timetables, transit maps, customer information, the design of the bus and rail fleet, the Metro website, merchandising, et cetera, et cetera. Just the last 2 days I've been sort of looking, and it's everywhere. The volume of output of their office is amazing, and it's all very beautifully designed, consistent, friendly, inviting, and cool at the same time. The Metro's creative services team has been a critical component in successfully winning new riders and new funding for mass transportation. The agency has received 80 plus awards since 2002, including honors from the Society of Environmental Graphic Designers and the Public Relations Society of America. Metro's work is included in AIGA's design archives and has been featured in the New York Times, the LA Times, Communication Arts, Creative Review, Fast Company, Print, Step Inside Design, How, and Los Angeles magazines. And in 2008, they received a 100 Best Of reward from Rebrand. Prior to joining Metro, Michael Lejeune was a project director at the award-winning design studio KBDA. He managed projects for Acura, Nikon, UCLA, and the Hilton Hotel chain. He also served as creative director for the City of Hope Cancer Center marketing department. Michael graduated from UCLA in 1986 with a degree in communication studies, and he is a past president of the Los Angeles chapter of the AIGA, which is the premier association for design professionals. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Michael Lejeune.
Thank you. I feel like I should say everybody has to move down front because it's like, you know, students that want to sit way in the back and sort of audit the class. Can you hear me, first of all? Okay. You all should be very, very thanked for coming out tonight. I know that you were all in traffic, as was I. A couple bits of housekeeping before we start. I'm going to take you on a journey, and I hope you'll find a little bit of yourself in this. There's probably a somewhat varied crowd here. But I want to say a couple thanks. Thanks to my wife, Jennifer, for making all of this possible and for my whole journey. And if there are any designers in the crowd or half crowd tonight, it's never too late to actually explain to your parents what you do. My mother is here tonight. I hope she won't mind me saying that she's 85 years old and she may finally get it tonight, what exactly I do. So I'm going to kind of barrel through a whole bunch of stuff. I'm telling a story that has a lot to do with design, but it has everything to do with the place we all call home, Los Angeles. And I would like to say one other thing, which is that technology is so imperfect even in today's age. And I've been kind of wrestling this keynote to the ground for most of the day. So I've had one beer, which helped me to forget all of that. And if something seems a little out of sync, it's because it is, because I was sort of blending things. Anyway, I usually tell the talk about Metro and Los Angeles, not in Los Angeles. So I like to start out by bringing the greetings of the big orange to the rest of the world, but I'm really, really happy to say greetings LA, or some very dedicated transit wonky, design wonky portion of LA that's actually here. And you know the way it is in Los Angeles. You're sitting around on the beach and you're hanging with your friends, right? Talking about public transportation. Pam says hi, by the way. And she takes the bus, you would not believe it. So, you know, this is what people think, right? That this is LA and this is what we do. But I want to take you back a little bit historically to what it really was. This is a beautiful postcard from Union Station, I'm going to guess around 1920. The happy news is that Union Station still looks quite a bit like this, and there are still cars in the parking lot, and I'm not sure about the orange trees, but it is a beautiful place. I'm also happy to say that Metro, on behalf of all the taxpayers of LA County, recently bought Union Station, so we have a very happy future coming in terms of how we're going to ripen and sort of shine that diamond. But it still looks like this. And it was kind of the Grand Central, if you will, of the day, and still is in a certain sense. You know, back in the 30s, we had one of the great transportation systems in the United States, the red car system. And it was really the envy of the country. And you could get from the top of Mount Lowe all the way to Santa Monica on a red car and never use your own car. And it was really something. And yet you can see that there are automobiles and everybody's living happily together and the skies are blue. And it was a pretty special time in Los Angeles. But then things started to shift a little bit. In the post-war era, we got into a heavy manufacturing situation and people moved to the suburbs and they could have a washing machine and this beautiful green Imperial. And of course, everybody in Los Angeles lived in this kind of a house, you know, overlooking the basin, and they all wore white tuxedos, you know, to dinner. So this is obviously advertising, but this is really sort of the dawn of the car era and what people aspired to, which was to, you know, have your own driveway and your own flagstone and your own, you know, ivy and lights and such, and a fantastic, you know, ragtop that you could tool around in. And that kind of idea just kept going, and then we added sex to it, right? So if the symbolism is lost on you, you can see me later and I'll explain it to you if you are over the age of 21. But this is really the way, you know, all the major car manufacturers have their design studios in Los Angeles. The car cruising was born in the valley in Los Angeles. This is really the kind of the situation that we built ourselves into, which was all about driving and getting your license and having your own car and then finding that woman in the striped bikini and you know what happens next. Even today, this is a picture of the Tesla all-electric Roadster, $100,000, and it's still, you know, it's still this incredibly groovy feeling. You're driving around Los Angeles in your shiny ragtop. You know, you're not emitting. It's really, really cool, and that's kind of what the world of cars is still putting out there. And on a kind of a personal note, when I was growing up in Los Angeles, I'm a native of LA and have lived here my whole life. Quite happily, but I've spent a lot of time in traffic. But when I was young, it was a little bit like that. This is a very significant interchange to me. This is the four level in downtown LA, and this was sort of like the gateway for me to everything. If we were going to the beach or to Dodger Stadium or to the Music Center or to my dad's office downtown, this was our interchange, and we would go this way, this way, this way, this way. And I remember so much as a kid being in the what we call the backety back of my parents' station wagon, which was a country squire with, you know, the siding and everything. And this is what I remember, is looking out the windows at night, kind of dozing and knowing that we were coming home, and I would see the lights and I could sort of tell where we were and we were making this turn and that turn. But you could get anywhere in LA, you know, it seemed like in 20 minutes. You could go from Pasadena to the beach or these sort of freak traffic jams that seem to spring up now at 2 in the morning or, you know, 2 in the afternoon or all the time. That wasn't my experience when I was a kid. It really worked. And the freeways were da bomb. You know, you really could, they really worked. And it kind of always felt like this, you know. It just felt like you were cruising and, you know, there was no limit to your speed and all that. But as you well know, that's not the way it is anymore. It actually, this is an unretouched photo, by the way, in case you were wondering. And I can't even tell you how many hours I spent on that freeway. And doesn't it just feel miserable, you know? Can't you just see the air and it just feels awful? But that's the way it is. So, but of course in LA,
we have a way of turning, you know, the not so great into something that's a little bit of a braggadocio. So we have had the worst traffic in the United States, as determined by the Texas Institute of Transportation, or Texas Transportation Institute. They kind of do the leading study on on nightmares, basically, on bad traffic. And the way they, I think the way that they index this out is actually quite clever, because it's not about this or that. What it really is about is literally how many hours you spend sitting in traffic. And so Los Angeles has had the worst traffic in the United States not once, not twice, it's not five times, 25 times in a row. 25 years in a row, the worst traffic in the country. So obviously, there's nowhere to go but up. But I have some very exciting news for you, and I know we're all going to be very proud of this. Last year, the big winner was not Los Angeles, Chicago. Please give yourselves a hand. My work is done, and now you may all go home. So back to this awful reality. What I think Metro and other agencies, there are many of them that struggle with this and try to change it. What we really are doing is reimagining the way LA can work. It's a very significant reimagination, because it has to do with whether a city works or not, whether people can get to work on time, whether they are frustrated, whether they can get home on time, whether companies can thrive or not. And it's kind of this nexus of billions and billions of dollars and political will and personal lifestyle. And you know, we are in the kind of the reimagination business. So we think, why does it have to be like this? Why can't getting to work feel like this? Hi, Melissa. I know you're out there. Or this, you know, a kind of a sun-filled car where you can turn around and talk to somebody and not rear-end the person in front of you. You know, instead of looking endlessly for a parking space in the structure that looks like the structure that looked like the structure from last week and next week, what if you pass through a really beautiful station like this with public art that is, you know, evokes an idea and challenges you? And of course, people will drive, so let's talk to them about carpooling and how groovy that can be, and how it's actually better than driving by yourself. You know, it doesn't need to feel like you're literally, you've been there for days and the arachnids have taken over your car. We think it can feel a little bit more like this. So now I'm going to launch into the boom, boom, boom of how we have kind of taken design as a shell for an idea and really put it to the service, we hope, of Los Angeles. I want to start with going back about 10 years, because this effort is really about 10 years old, although Metro has been around in one iteration or another longer than that. But this real concentration on an emphasis on design and communication really has been about a 10-year thing. So a quick look at conditions on the ground. When we started, this was sort of where we were. You may remember that Metro built a subway, and during that time we had a big gas explosion, and it was a real mess. And that was kind of somewhat indicative of how hard it was to impose this new system on Los Angeles. And so there wasn't a lot, you know, that wasn't a great builder of public trust when you're building and, you know, things explode and it takes a long time, and there was a 10-year lawsuit with the contractor and yada yada. And at the same time, we have a very active group called the Bus Riders Union, who's saying Metro is racist and is actually really emphasizing rail service over bus service. These are all legitimate, by the way, arguments or points of view. But what I'm really trying to say is that on the outside, there was not a lot of faith or trust in Metro and other public agencies to spend your tax dollars wisely and to get us to where we needed to go. On the inside, when I started, my first day at Metro, I encountered this, which is a bell. And it was on a counter in what used to be called the graphics department. And if you wanted some piece of communication done, you would come and ring the bell. And whoever had the time would get up and come and talk to you, and you'd say, I want a brochure on the new Red Line station that's gonna open, and here's my floppy disk, and there's a photo on here, and there's some copy in Word 22 or 33 or whatever year it was invented. And that's the way design happened at Metro. It was sort of literally order taking by Bell. So we blew up the Bell, first of all, and we changed the name of that space to the design studio. Here's the kind of stuff that was being put out. And people worked hard on this. I don't mean to disparage the efforts at all, but when you're trying to make the case for public transportation in Los Angeles, you need to break through the clutter. This is a place of great design, adoption. This is a place where images are everything. This is the entertainment industry, and this kind of stuff is not really going to get people on the bus, even though we claimed that it was getting better on the bus. Here's another one. I love that sort of toothpaste font. I don't know what they called that, but it's so groovy and shiny. And then this is the thing that was really this freaky... I'm so glad you're laughing. This freaky standard for Los Angeles. Here's how we market public transportation. A three-quarter view of the vehicle. Every single time, right? That's all you need. They will run. They'll run to the vehicle and get on it. They'll grab the back bumper if it's pulling away, right? And this is actually a pretty important document. This is about the future of transit, right? This is a document that explains how we're all going to work together. Here's my very favorite. I'll wait. Are you reading? If we're late, you don't pay. Now, can you imagine a bus that starts in Santa Monica on Wilshire Boulevard and has to get downtown, and it's in the same traffic that all of us are in? There is no way it's going to be on time. I picture this person constantly giving out, vouchers, like in downtown LA, So what did we do? We had to start somewhere, and we did. This is the first piece. Is Matt, are you here? No? Yeah. There he is. So Matt, this is the first piece that I actually worked on, I think within maybe the first week or two I was at Metro. This is a very important effort, actually. First of all, you'll see a lot of these tall, skinny things are called take ones. We put them on our buses and on our trains. If you've ridden transportation, you would know this. And it's kind of the standard that that you can go and literally take, and we cover most of the things that we're talking about end up as a take one, as I quickly discovered. So this take one is about trying to recruit bus operators. And you can imagine, we have 2,300 buses in the Metro system alone, in addition to all the other local operators. There's something like 4,000 or 5,000 bus operators that drive these buses all day long. And if we can't recruit people, qualified people, then who's going to drive your bus or your train? So the directive was, we just want to update this. Everything's fine. Design-wise, it's, set your future in motion. And the pay is pretty good, so we're going to put that right on the front. And all we want to do is change this photo, because we use this black woman operator. Last year, we were thinking of maybe an Asian male operator this year. But other than that, it's great, and we're going to go with it. And I said, can we jump in here? The analogy that I have for Metro is that this river of information flowing all the time. And we were all sort of new to it. And I said, could we just jump in and try something a little bit different? And Matt said, absolutely, but you can't miss the deadline. And we're going to have paid media. And, you have 3 days, basically. So the first day was spent in a bonfire. And then, we just kind of jumped in and thought, okay, let's try something different. Let's try a different kind of a voice. Let's try a little bit of humor, maybe. If you like big steering wheels. It's a huge steering wheel, right? It's really big. So that kind of was a weird beginning to the Metro voice, and then we kind of got rolling, and Matt said, now we want to be a good citizen in Los Angeles County. So let's talk about the fact that, A, we have a problem, which is that people tag our buses, and and they leave trash on the buses and in the stations, and we want to kind of point that out. So we went ahead with, okay, we're now going to kind of be a good citizen and say, take care of your own system. And again, it's at this point, our design is barely sort of coming into fruition, but it's really about the voice that we're talking about. You know, you paid for the station. Why aren't you keeping it clean? You know, really tagging? It's so last century. You know? So that was kind of the beginning. That's about 3 weeks worth of, you know, effort, or maybe 3 months. But we really hadn't even begun to tackle everything. We were just plucking these little bits out of the river that flowed. And then we took a hard look around at how Metro is saying we are Metro. Well, this is how they're saying we're Metro. We have 37 logos and for things like the IT department. I'm looking at this now. I can't even remember, you know. It's really easy to recreate the logo, by the way. You can do it in Word. You can draw it yourself. These are all real examples of the logo. None of them are correct. My favorite is the upper left corner. That's in a newspaper ad for recruiting people to work at Metro. Completely wrong. So we gave it a new logo, very simple, a place to start, an emphasis on Metro, which was our service name. We built a kind of a system around it. We got, you know, if this was a true design audience, we would just stop on this slide and sort of, you know, salivate for a while, right? You know, two typefaces, and here's the color palette, but you don't care about that. But anyway, we imparted some rigor, and that really helped us to feel like we were on our way. And again, Metro, we were known as MTA to a lot of people, unless you were an actual customer. And there were lots of customers, but to everybody else, we were the MTA. Metropolitan Transportation Authority. How friendly is that? The authority would like you to get on the bus now. You know, so we thought, well, we're going to introduce ourselves. You know, psst, call us Metro. Thank you anyway. This is my favorite one. We put this up. Let me tell you, this is like 6 months in. I literally could not believe that we were getting away with this. I'm looking right at Matt. Really? We can write this kind of stuff? My favorite thing is that somebody called the customer information line and said, you should get your money back because they've made a terrible error on your billboard. I love that. So we just kind of jump in, and I'm going to kind of, you know, cruise along here. We start developing these take ones. We start bringing color to things. My favorite one is the one on the right here. We have a rigorous system, and yet we allow that it can, you know, be manipulated and change a little bit. So these are all Metro. The logo's in the right spot. It's bright, it's colorful, you know, it's from us, but this great intern named Daniel, we gave him this assignment to do the X Games brochure, and this is what he came back with. He cut up pieces of type, he photographed himself wearing the, you know, the skater's helmet, he ripped paper, and he brought it in, his hands are sort of shaking, like, maybe we could try this, and I said, absolutely, this is fantastic, you know, because that's really what it is to be able to have a system that can morph and change while still being consistent enough that people know where you're coming from. This is one of the first photos that we ever shot. And I love that. That really, to me, kind of symbolizes what we were putting out there, which is everybody takes Metro. You know, Lucha Libre was a huge thing at that time. More than half of our riders, Spanish is their first language. And so why don't we talk to them? We're not talking down to anybody. We're saying everybody takes Metro. This is a Metro security guard, by the way. And he has to keep most of this, particularly the cape, when it was all done. Although I kept the mask, and my son loves it. We were wearing it the other day. I don't want to talk about that, though. So now we're kind of rolling. We're shooting our own photography. We're starting to really put out a different image. You know, does this look like public transportation to you? Where's the three-quarter shot of the bus? How will I know what I'm supposed to do? That's the point. And we open up the Gold Line, which was really exciting for me because that is my line. That line runs right through my hometown of South Pasadena. And on a really good day, I ride my bike to the train station, I get on the train, and I go downtown, and I'm at my building. So I was saying to Claudia earlier, I used to drive 2 hours a day all the way out here from South Pass for probably 10 years. And this job turned out to be like karma for me, pardon the pun, in a way, because now I truly have the dream commute, and I'm still alive, and I'm not a cow. So I think it's pretty amazing that you know, this happens. So we open the goal line. We make a big splash because it's one of our first new lines. We go really big. And then, just as a reminder of how hard public transportation is, we go on strike. 6 months, I think, after the goal line opens. So we go from this and this, you know, all over the city celebrating a brand new line that opens up a new vein, and it's kind of the first and, you know, of many that we hope to come. Not the first, but it really sort of opens up the system, but we're also really putting it out there that we're opening up this line. We go from this to a strike, legitimate labor gripes, I'm sure. And so we go from that kind of a talking to this is what we were saying. Although I'm very keen on punctuation, so we were actually saying that. I had to put the period at the end of it. And so I just put that in there to illustrate that there are lots, you know, it's not like selling iPods where you buy your media and you make sure that your manufacturing is there and you build these amazing palaces of technology and people literally camp out overnight. This is public transportation. We're pushing an idea that you didn't want to hear about, you know? You have your car. You don't need this. It's sort of something that exists in the collective blind spot of a certain category of people who have the choice. And so this is really, you know, not only do we have to put it out there in this very busy world, but we have these forces that can sometimes, you know, take over and stop us from even operating our service. Anyway, so quickly, how do we work? I thought that might be interesting, but I'm going to barrel through it. The first thing that we did was really take all of the functions of the agency that we're communicating and bring them all together, and all of their money as well. So this slide is hard for you to read probably, but it was really just about all the different ways that Metro was communicating all over this 10,000 person agency, bringing them all together under one roof. I talked to you about that bell. This is the door to our fantabulous studio. And you know, this is what it's like to work sometimes in the public sector is, it's cubicles and it's fluorescent and it's not that beautiful, you know, frosted glass and brushed steel that you see at so many wonderful design firms, and there's not a little carafe of, you know, iced coffee waiting for you because it's your money that's paying for it. So we're pretty bare bones. But when you get behind the door, you know, the fun starts, and we do our own decorating. We have a job for everything. We are all about collective thinking. This was from a review that, or a kind of a retreat that we had. I thought this was sort of interesting to throw in because we get so many different people from different walks of the design world or just different areas, photographers and writers and public relations people. And we brought the crew together once for a retreat, and I said, in one word, will you please tell me why you're here? Because it's not necessarily for a paycheck that's bigger than anybody else's, and the benefits are good, but it's not about glory, and it's not about, you know, designing yet necessarily award-winning campaigns. And I just thought it was interesting that this is what people came up with. The hangman, of course, is my favorite. He was actually here for fun, and we do have a lot of fun. But we go through a rigorous process. We pin up. We endlessly labor over words because everything we do is imparting information, and it matters, and our voice is very important to what we do. And so we mark things up, and we mess things up, and we just kind of take a look at how we can express the Metro idea. I would use the word brand, but it's really more than a brand. It's an idea, and how we can communicate that to anybody who is paying attention. So quickly, everybody loves before and afters. This is what our timetables used to look like. A lot of information, as you can see. We blew that up, and they now are a very nice system that still imparts all of that information, but does it in a much cleaner way. It's all about information at Metro, especially where the rubber hits the road, which is this kind of thing. When is my bus going to be here? So, you know, we adopted two typefaces, we unified, we're still working on timetables. We have jobs in the studio right now to update timetables and consider the way the maps work. We're kind of never done in that way. This is what a map used to look like, a little tough to read. You know, here's all our service, right? And in that circle, what I think that was meant to be is, here's where you are on the street. But, you know, it really should look like this, a little bit 3D, a little bit like if you come out of this entrance at Union Station, oh, if I walk across the street, I'm at Overo Street, or, you know, there's City Hall. I can walk three blocks and get to someplace. Because There's always that element of walking that's part of a metro trip, as we say. And, you know, so we have to take care of that and make sure people know about it. This was one of our early take ones. How about that guy? His name is Safety Guy. This is a very, very serious brochure, by the way, about not stepping in front of a train on train tracks. And it just seemed like, I don't know, the knee pads. He has a vest on, it's true. Anyway, so that's kind of where we went to, is a series of brochures that hang together. They're colorful. All these icons are our own. We customize everything. And, you know, that to me is something that you'd want to pick up. And it's very clearly stated, here's what it is, you know. And there's a little something for everybody. Here's where you can go. Here's where you can bike. Here's the basics you need to know about buying tickets. Here's how you connect. And here's the big system map. And they all go together. This is actually a true, real, unretouched sign from one of our busiest areas, which is the El Monte station, which, by the way, just got an amazing redo and just opened. It's the busiest bus terminal west of the Mississippi, I think. But this was like, you know, customer signage, pedestrian entrance. Here's how you get in. And there's like skateboard stickers on it, you know, and schmutz. So we went to something, you know, it's all about clarity with us. If you want to go this way, you're going to get to these places. If you want to go this way, you're going to get to these places. Really clear signage. There are the two lines that this station serves. Very, very simple. Everything is information for us. We have to talk to our own employees about how to lift boxes. And so this demonstrates the depth of our design program. We are doing, you know, not just the things that customers see, but we're doing the things that keep our own employees, you know, healthy and safe. And I'm so proud to say that Metro does everything. We don't, you know, we have people that help us that maybe aren't in the studio every day, but we are overseeing every aspect of visual communication for this agency. And it's pretty unusual, and it's an incredible challenge, but it's very rewarding. And then we have to have fun too. So this is this great bus driver who I don't think they told him about the Shrek ears. But you know, really, design can and this warmth can be in anything that you do. So this is the Metro family picnic in essence. But you know, isn't that better than just, you know, saying family picnic or showing a picture of Universal Studios? We even do the employee badges, and this is Napoleon, who is one of our seeing eye dogs. Security dogs. And we love that photo. So here's one of our mantras. LA is the most amazing, unique, original place. It's not like any place. No place is like any place else, but LA is particularly one of a kind. And so we want to create one of a kind design to really reflect the community that we're living in. This is what our buses used to look like. If you are of a certain age, you will remember that. Travel smart, take Metro. That's illiterate in a certain sense. It's not good English. And even worse, if you'll pardon me for being opinionated, and I know you will, you know, think about Los Angeles, all the cars on the street, delivery vans, pickup trucks, gardener's trucks, rental cars. White, really? White? I mean, it just disappears, you know? It's like, it's almost like we don't want to be seen, you know, in our own city. So one of the first sort of new employees of the Metro Design Studio was a fantastic guy named Neil Sadler. And he was like a wind-up toy of design. He just would go and go and go. And we had kind of a different, I would go to these meetings and listen to people gripe, and he would go and explore. And one day he explored across the street and found out that we have a paint shop. Metro's big. We have lots of different yards, lots of different facilities, and we have this paint shop. And when buses get into the occasional fender bender or to get wonky at their midlife when they're coming in to get everything replaced so they can go back on the street and drive for 5 more years, they get painted. And so Neil said, well, why? It doesn't have to be white. Why don't we make them much more colorful? And we did. And now they're the juicy. You've seen them. You see them everywhere, right? You see them from, you know, 3 blocks away. They're bright red, and they're bright California poppy. And, you know, we customize the what we call the badging, the type on the sides, and we worked with 3M, and we have this super reflective material so that when headlights rake across them at night, there's our brand right there. By the way, they're safer, and you see them, and therefore, you know, less accidents. And So this was one of the biggest changes that we had right away, was to redesign our fleet and to announce ourselves as this very bright, colorful, purveyor of rides, if you will. And Matchbox really liked it because they made, isn't that cute? We are the only transit agency in the country to have our own Matchbox car. So now my son knows what I do as well as my mother, which is pretty great. So, you know, we just started riffing. Here's a couple of posters. You know, I don't want to see a three-quarter view of a bus. I'd rather talk about missing traffic or how you walk a little bit and so you lose a little weight and Metro's actually good for you. Or, oh, by the way, you know, Mother Earth is going to stop sweating if you would get on the damn bus. So, you know, that was sort of the idea of some of these. And this is one of my favorites. Again, could not believe, this is about our website, that I could write a headline like this, you know, with a thinly veiled drug reference and still have it work. All of our models, by the way, are employees, which saves us a ton of money and it builds camaraderie, and these two don't look anything like this, I can tell you. In fact, the guy on the left, he doesn't have much hair, if I'm remembering. But anyway, some fun. As I said, Custom for Los Angeles, this is a series of posters that the public art group, which is part of our creative services group, does each year. And these are completely originated ideas by local artists. Anybody can do it. Anybody in this audience who has an idea, who wants to do a photograph, a painting. Many of the people who have been commissioned, it's their first piece of art that they've ever created or sold in a public space. But I just love this idea that there are all these neighborhoods and that Metro takes you there and that each of them kind of reflects a different thing and they're in a different medium. You know, and then we also have to be sort of geo-targeting when we open a line. So when we opened a lot, we were opening a lot of Metro Rapid lines, which is the fast bus that goes about 25% faster and stops every mile instead of every two blocks. And so we would buy these ads in local areas. But I also wanted, I just keep the slide in forever because we got to say fast, frequent, fabulous, and you know. Who else says fabulous about public transportation but us? So, here's a station pole, lighting pole on the new East Side extension of the Gold Line. Not so new anymore, but you know, again, the California poppy, really clear, simple signage. But this idea of something that's a little bit more, our signage is just so simple and beautiful on new lines that we're building, and I'm really proud of that. And signage is one of the hardest things to do because it's endless iteration, and we have a group, very dedicated group in-house that just churns these things out. This is a porcelain art piece on the Orange Line, which is the bus that acts like a train in the valley. Very, very popular. It's on a fixed street, so it's a bus that really is like a train. It stops every mile or so. There are stations, and you know, we find ways with lots of little pockets of space to build in these rich, kind of colorful, unique experiences. And so here again are the California poppies in this porcelain piece. And we're very much a part of the community. Jody, I think I saw Jody out there. So every year we're in the West Hollywood Pride Parade, and a group of employees gets out there, and we take a bus, and we do a banner. And that's one of my favorite things for us to do because it's really about being, you know, in the community. Now, here's a blank slide, and I can't remember what it is. Let's see.
Everybody, go.
Okay, hold on. Sorry. So we're doing all this stuff, and now it's time to maybe put some motion to things and to get onto TV because it is Los Angeles. So this first commercial I'm going to show you is one of two that we, one of a series that we did. But this first one was truly guerrilla kind of thing. We had a production company, we had a small amount of money, we had a situation where, because if you've ever worked in a big company, you have to spend your money by a certain time before the fiscal year runs out, or you won't have the money next year, which is not true, but that's what they tell you. And so we had 2 weeks to do commercials, and we didn't really know what we were going to do, but we got on a bus with a stand-up comedian that we had hired, who I will never speak to again, by the way, because he was two weeks on a bus with a stand-up comedian, and me is like Chinese water torture. But anyway, this is the first piece we turned out, very, very low budget, but I thought that it was really kind of a fun first salvo about, you know, the Metro attitude.
Everybody, go Metro. Remember this, go Metro. I need you guys to leave your car here and then go hop on the bus. You, ma'am, go Metro. And quit smoking, it's not good for you. Hey, bus driver, go Metro. I guess they're already going Metro. Or else they wouldn't have to. Tell them.
So can you tell there was no script on that? But, you know, it's about people riding, and there's the person with the laptop and the sort of the camaraderie. So the next thing is that this production company comes back to Matt and says, we want to do some more, and we have this great idea. We work with this actor, who's a very nice guy, by the way, and we're trying to sell a script to a studio. This is a perfect L.A. Metro meets Hollywood story. The production company says, we're trying to sell a script to a studio, and it's about this guy named Squeegee Lowe, and the idea is that he was born a poor child and an orphan, but he turns out to be the world's greatest dancer, and so we want to use this character, but we want to use this character in a Metro commercial. And Matt said, okay, Michael, figure out how we can do that. And I said, you got to be kidding me. And he said, no, this is a really good idea. We're gonna figure out how to use this, and these guys really want to work with us again. And by the way, the actor, what's his name? Terry Crews, who's actually quite popular and does a lot of things. He's like 6'3", and he is truly the Incredible Hulk. He is extremely muscle bound, 6'3", bald black man who actually is a very good dancer. But you know, we've been doing these clever print ads and colorful, and I had no idea what we were going to do. So we riffed and riffed and riffed, and this is what we came up with.
Traffic every day. Sig alerts, men at work's backside hurts. Traffic, money down the drain. Bitter, baby. Stop, go, stop. Vessels in my mind go pop. Metro sweet. From here till infinity. The answer? Metro. Metro.
How weird is that? I'll tell you how weird it is. It's so weird that Matt wouldn't even show it to our CEO. I think we just put it on the air and didn't tell anybody. We did 5 of those, by the way, and they're kind of cool. That's that guy from The Sopranos, whatever his name is, and it was this sort of beat poetry thing. He had to dance, so we had to figure out how we were going to get him to dance and talk about Metro at the same time. But you're getting the sense that we're playing kind of fast and loose, and yet we are out there, you know, we're out there in the community, and we're out there putting an idea out about change, you know, in your life. And we're signaling change by changing the way we're talking about the city's transportation. So a couple of quick stories. This is the way you sort of wrestle with the kind of work that you have to do and turn it into something that will, I think, appeal and work better and actually be more successful than it was. Somebody called me shortly after we started and said, I hear you're the new design guy. They said, I want to ask you a question. Could you, maybe you could come up to my office. And so I walked up the stairs, 3 floors to a whole floor that I hadn't really been on yet, which is where all the planning people were. And this woman said, this is this very important document called the Long Range Transportation Plan. This is what it looks like. It is a very key document because it's basically the vision piece for how we're going to spend millions and billions of dollars over the next 25 years. It's a blueprint for what Metro is going to do, what they would build, what projects. And she said, we've already done this. We have an outside company that has designed this, and they're going to do it again. But what I wanted to know from you is, this is what it looks like inside. Do you think this year we should make it 2 columns of type instead of 3 columns of type? You can imagine how honored I was to be asked that incredibly scintillating question. And I said, well, instead of answering that, could we talk about this document? Tell me what it is and what it's for. And we spent an hour together. She's actually now one of my great colleagues, and she's as dramatic as ever, but she really, you know, it turns out that I really had to kind of come to understand what this thing was. And at the end of the hour, I said, let's make a deal. Let us have a crack at it. Let this burgeoning studio, which is 4 floors below you and you don't even know about, Let us take a crack at telling the story. This is a very important document. This should be inspiring. This should be something that people would want to read. And I'm not sure, I said, that it is right now. It's probably the three columns of type that's really holding it back. Could be great with two, I don't know, but anyway. So she's, and I said, Anne, if you don't like it, you can go to your outside studio that you already have cash flowing with, and they can do it for you. So she said yes, and we all got together, and we crafted some storylines, and we thought about different ways to do it. And this is what, let's go back, if you would. That's what it looked like. There's nothing wrong. It's nice and clean. Black, he's a red type, a nice photo of Los Angeles. But this is what it became. Right there, you know. That's different, right? That's about the future. That's about who's going to ride Metro and how much joy there might be in a city that would work. And we put it all in first person, and we told the story of how people want a better commute. And, oh, look, we're going right over that freeway with all the traffic in it. Mm-hmm. And say, is that a train in the background? I'm not sure, but I could play soccer. And, you know, there are charts, and there are graphs. There's the one about pollution and how much we're not polluting. And, you know, our solar panels on some of our facilities. The great thing about this job, and there are many great things, but you could write a line that says we're creating a better world and you can actually mean it, you know? And that's pretty groovy. So that's what it became. Here's another quick story. One of our favorite clients, Rafi, who is the federal legislative affairs person for Metro, goes to Washington many times a year with a handout saying, please, we need millions and billions of dollars to build more transportation in LA. But he's right there in line with many, many lobbyists and many people from every other major transportation, major and sort of minor transportation agency in the country. They all have their handout, and as you know, the pot is not very big of money and getting smaller all the time. So he said, we are not making the case. Los Angeles is one of the economic engines of the United States. We have the biggest port system in the United States. We have goods coming off of our ships that need to get, you know, through this miasma of traffic and deliver iPods and T-shirts to Walmart in, you know, anywhere, Texas, North Carolina. And we're not getting our fair share of federal funding commensurate with the population and the economy and the people we serve. And this is the smoking gun right here, he said. I said, no, that's not a smoking gun, that's an Excel sheet. But basically, it is a smoking gun because the highlighted column there, which he had to explain to us, and we designers ask a lot of questions and want to know how things work. He said, this shows all the awards to other places and their population and how much money they got to start new programs and build new things. And couldn't we do this a little better? And I said, I think we could. And I gave it to this fantastic intern named Cindy, who worked with us for many subsequent years. And this is what she did, which is, oh, wow. The green circle represents the amount of money that areas got. And then we also list that money. So I don't know if you can see. Let's take, for instance, Salt Lake City, with a population of 1.1 million people, got $180 million. Los Angeles, with 12 million people, got $9.5 million. And it's our fault, right? Because we weren't making the case well. So this one page, this map, became sort of a really potent thing that took on a life of its own. And in fact, when you saw the mayor earlier bragging on his transportation system, when he went to Washington to meet with Obama, it turns out the way it works sometimes in the world of scheduling and politics, as the story is told to me by Rafi, he had 2 minutes on the tarmac at the airport, you know, the stairs that come down from Air Force One. He had 2 minutes to talk to Obama, a scheduled 2 minutes to meet with him. And this is the one piece of paper that he handed him. And so what can design do? It's simple. It can really tell a story. This is one of our most, I think, successful and popular campaigns, but it started out as a very simple idea. We were leading up to a very complicated dance of politics and elections, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. But Matt the Brain Trust said, we need to present Metro as the solution to LA's woes. Now, we can't be the solution to all LA's woes. And if you're Metro, You can't, you know, point at people driving alone and say, you stink. You know, you have to be a little bit more diplomatic than that. But what can we rail against, right? We can rail against gas prices. We can rail against driving alone. We can rail against traffic. We can rail against pollution. And we want to be seen as a solution to that. So what was a very simple idea became a kind of a complicated design problem that had tons and tons of pieces of paper on the wall and ended up at one of the really most simple and, I think, elegant things that we've ever done, which is this sort of opposites campaign. Problem is gas, we're the solution. The villain is gas, we're the hero. Ooh, it's so bitter when you have to fill up that tank again. You know, traffic stresses, we're the relief. One person in a car less, metro more. And there's beautiful Maxwell. Traffic is naughty and we're nice, right? We never underestimate the power of a t-shirt. We gave away a lot of these t-shirts to sort of tastemakers and people around town. And this is the Intelligentsia Coffee Company in Silver Lake. They all wore their t-shirts while they served coffee. And that's a sort of a kind of staged but real photo of Intelligentsia people. So here's another thought that we've had. We can do all of this, but we're still pushing an idea out on other people. What if we kind of riff and let other people be our amplifiers? You may have heard of a little something called Carmageddon, or Carmageddon 2. You know, this thing was crazy. It took on this countdown life of its own, right? We're going to close the 405 in 25 seconds, and the world will end, literally. This little widget that you know works just like this and started out obviously with, you know, 20 days, 19 days, et cetera, ended up being run in the New York Times, papers across the country. We got calls from Europe. What is this Carmageddon thing going on? And that's just a simple idea about something that people were so fascinated. You're panicking because you're going to close one freeway, you know? But it really took on this sort of amazing life. We're trying to really embrace every kind of future thing that we can. And QR codes hopefully will be the thing that everybody will use on their phone, because everybody uses a phone and everybody has a smartphone, or 83%, probably everybody in this room has a smartphone. So we're kind of looking at a pithy way to use things like QR codes. What if instead of a printed piece where we have all these contacts and when you go to a public meeting, we say to you, we've tackled just about everything. Almost exactly 4 years ago, next Tuesday or a week from Tuesday, or a little bit before that, we thought, or some of us, not me actually, but very smart people thought, it's time to really test the brand in a kind of a big way. You remember that Rafi had to take that Excel sheet and make the case that we weren't getting enough money, and the governor was taking money away because the budget in California was not balanced, and so money that was voted on by voters to go to transportation projects through gas tax and through various other things was just sort of snatched out of budgets and put to use somewhere else for prison guards or education or whatever it might be. So really, the thought became, we need to steer our own ship. We need to secure our own funding. We need to find a way that we can collectively build a bigger system, because we're not gonna build our way out of this with freeways. We can't build freeways anymore, and we are very, very sort of at the limit in terms of impact. So that became something that went on the November 2008 ballot called Measure R. If you don't know about it, you will, because 25 years from now, there will be a completely new Los Angeles, and that's based on money coming from Measure R. There will be a subway, beautiful subway stop right outside here, practically, that will serve Westwood and UCLA, and that subway will keep going. And that's money that comes from Measure R. It was a Hail Mary pass, as actually a very official report called it, when looking at how the hell it actually passed later. But it was this idea that, would you tax yourself, LA County? Will you tax yourself another half penny on everything you buy, from pantyhose to groceries to, you know, anything in LA County, if that money goes to transportation projects only in Los Angeles County, only for Los Angeles County? So we created materials, public information materials for Measure R. And as you remember, November 2008 was a kind of an important election. A lot of young voter engagement, a lot of new voters, a lot of excitement. And so it was a really great time And kind of the only time, as it turns out, that we could have put this thing on the ballot and hoped that LA County would, quote unquote, you know, go for it, or a very high bar, which was 2/3 of voters had to go for it. If we waited even 6 more months, the economy crashed and nobody would tax themselves anymore because they were all, or many people were unemployed, and the idea of more taxation was simply unthinkable. So we threw up this Hail Mary pass, and here's what happened, in case you missed it. 67.93% of voters said yes. We needed to have 67.5% of the voters say yes. So again, that's an incredible squeak that we basically did. And what does that mean? We're in the money, that's what it means. It means about $40 billion over the next 30 years for us, for you, for rail, for better bus service, for lots of other things, for a kind of a new Los Angeles. And this is the only time I'm gonna say this, and I'm saying this as a private citizen. In 2 weeks, you have a chance to vote on something called Measure J, which is saying, will you extend that sales tax for another 30 years? If you choose that that would be a good idea, we can build a whole bunch of projects faster because we can borrow money against the money that we know is coming in over the next 30 years. So it's very self-explanatory, that's all I can say, but I would like everyone to vote one way or another, and please read that ballot measure carefully. We worked very, very hard on it on behalf of LA County. So what it really means is let's build. Let's put people to work. Let's take the rail infrastructure we have and double it. Let's look at the way we can interface our bus service with it. Let's build more transit ways like the Orange Line that are less expensive than rail, but work just as well and can serve a great number of people. Let's figure out about bike paths. Let's add more carpool lanes. Let's work on the 405. Let's open express lanes, which is a new service coming in about 2 months or a month, where you can choose to use a carpool lane as a single driver if you pay. And if you want to pay, you can go 45 miles an hour guaranteed, and you can get to where you're going fast. So this is the future, and it's really the only way that LA is going to get anywhere, because as I said, freeways are not happening anymore. So now it becomes about this vocabulary. These are 40 some odd illustrations that we have commissioned from a great guy named Paul Rogers, who is an Art Center instructor and a fantastic illustrator. We need to talk about all the different ways that LA County is going to change. And so this idea of everything being in the works seemed to us a kind of fresh way of reporting and sort of fomenting fervor for change, because it is going to be the largest public works collective effort in Los Angeles County since probably the Great Depression. And so, how can we talk about the future and keep people with us as we start to dig really big holes and make really big messes? This is about getting people to hang with us, if you will, during what's going to be a hard time for LA, but a very exciting time. And so we're really about the big picture. Help us plan the future of the Crenshaw Corridor. More rail is in the works, It's a better commute and traffic relief and all of these things. And so we use every available avenue we have, and we create all these illustrations. And then the mayor, who is actually kind of a fan and likes what we do a lot, said, great, I'm going to have a press conference in 3 days, and I would like something to start that press conference out. So I need something in 3 days. And this is also a great example of how we work. Very shoestring, but how do we take these static illustrations that we've created and put them together into something that conveys the big picture? wife and remembers how fast you could go and had to leave. I think I had to leave at like 2 to get here by 6 or something today, you know, as all of you did. It's really a pleasure and a little bit of an honor and also a great challenge to find myself and our amazing team in this position of being civic boosters and kind of, you know, carrying a torch for our hometown. It's never been more exciting. Don't move out of LA because it's gonna be great in the next 25 years. Please be patient, you know, because you're gonna have to drive around something every once in a while. And so I'm almost at the end, and then when I am at the end, you have to cheer for every empty seat, you know, 3 times as loud. But one of the things that we've really felt at the beginning is that you can have fun doing what you're doing. When I was interviewing for this job, which was the newly created position of creative director, I needed a change and a shift, and it was time for me to do something else, as it was for a lot of people who've come to join us subsequently. And I was sitting in Matt's office, and I didn't know him or Maya from Boo, and I said, so what's the goal here? You know, I understand you want to get people on the bus or the train, but what's the real goal? And he said, that's easy. The goal is to make Metro cool. And it sounded so sort of flip, like, oh, sure, make Metro cool. The authority, make the authority cool. But really, that has been our through line, because that's what it takes in Los Angeles, is you have to have a different, you have to present a different idea about this life-changing thing that nobody wants. You know, we'd all rather be in our foreign import, you know, with our own tunes and shaving, or, you know, the way the woman did this, like, you know, the eyeliner and the mirror. And now they do it on the bus instead, actually. But it's about adopting a different way of being. So fun is a part of our mantra, because not just because it makes it rewarding for us, you know, to say, oh, gas is dumb, you can be smart, you know, but because it's a nice way to talk to Los Angeles, and I think a way that gets people's attention. We have a new, relatively new CEO. He instituted a dress code, so the men had to wear ties, so we said, okay, fine, let's make a tie, you know, if we have to wear it, let's have it be cool. From the very first year that we were together as a kind of a new studio, Neil had this great idea, which I just love. I thought it was so brilliant. He said, let's make Valentine for Los Angeles on Valentine's Day. And I said, what do you mean? He said, well, here, I've got this sketch. And of course, it was the most exquisitely detailed picture of our building, and it had every window in the entire building. He had done this like over a 24-hour period. And what it became is, we run up and down the stairs and turn off lights and turn on lights. This is 10 people doing this. And we close doors, and we have radios and phones, and I stand on the platform and say, no, no, 23, you have to close that door. And we create a 12-story Valentine to Los Angeles. And you can see it from 5 freeways, and I just love that. We also made shoes once. The lights really work, thanks to Melissa's husband, who's a lighting designer. Those are Tom's shoes for a local AIGA thing. So fun takes a lot of forms, but it makes our days worthwhile. And it sometimes takes some surprising forms. I'm confident enough after 10 years that I can show you this next slide. I was sitting with one of my favorite collaborators, a guy named David Zeitz, who shot many of our campaigns that you've seen up here. And we were working up an X campaign, and we were sort of thinking about, it was the time when the gas prices were really skyrocketing. We were trying to think about a way that we could kind of show the shock of high gas prices. And we came up with this idea that we would have this mime who was so incredibly, you know, horrified at how high gas prices were. And so we're sitting in the conference room, and I'm saying, yeah, I totally get it. The mime can be like this, you know, and like this, and oh, no. And he said, absolutely. And I said, okay, now we're going to have to find somebody. We're going to have to find an employee who's really willing to, they've got to have a lot of personality, you know, and they've got to be really willing. He said, oh, it's going to be you. I said, no, it's not. He said, it has to be you. Who else could do it? We only have 30 minutes to get the shot, and then we have to go on. You have to have fun, right? So back to that wrestler. Here's where he landed. Let everybody else wrestle with traffic. And, you know, it is LA, so you got to kind of poke fun a little bit, right? This is a very important slide to me. This is like a Big Brother slide. Yes, we're filming you. You're damn right. But you look great. So, I'm almost done. What's down the road? At this retreat that we were at, we kind of ended this incredibly stimulating day. This is 5 years ago. This is before a lot of what you've seen had actually come to pass. And we kind of ended the day saying, so what, you know, the mantra is make Metro cool, but what do we really want to happen? If we make Metro cool, what are we really hoping for? And I don't know who said it, but somebody came up with this really interesting, wonderful idea, which is, if you live in New York, you can't imagine life without a subway or, you know, a taxi or those forms of collective public transportation, and I include taxis in that, or even buses, or walking on the street, or biking. You know, this is the way the city thrives and moves. It is literally a part of the fabric of New York and so many other cities, and it's not in Los Angeles. You know, what people seemed to want a while ago in Los Angeles was to walk out of their drive, their house, get in their car, roll up all the windows, right? That's what we used to do when I was a kid, sorry. Now you do that. And drive away and not talk to anybody until they get to their office and then park their car and get in the elevator and go up their office. And then they do the whole thing in reverse. And it's not a collective experience. It's actually a completely individual, somewhat selfish experience. And, you know, if you get in my way and cut me off, you know what I'm going to do to you, right? That's the way it was. But we imagined this idea that moving together and being together could be really part of a different collective experience in Los Angeles. So what is down the road? I think what we hope is that down the road we're going to have these amazing spaces. This is the new Grand Park in downtown, which I encourage you all to go and see. It's really cool. But Metro's going to be there, you know. You're going to go to Disney Hall and whoosh, there goes that flash of orange right in front of you. You know, the light and the color of going out at night in LA, which is so much fun, and there's so many amazing places to be, is going to be there. But, oh, you might see it from inside a bus instead of your own car, you know. We're going to go to the Wheel Turn and we're going to see a great act. But, oh, there's a station right there, so we could take the train instead. And we don't have to park. Ciclovia, which you heard Claudia talk about earlier, is an amazing thing if you haven't done it. It really is a completely, you know, otherworldly experience to be riding down these streets with all these people, crazy bikes, and, you know, looking for William Masterman, who's lost two blocks ahead. It was an amazing experience for me and my friends, you know, and that's something that Metro is a part of as well. And what if you can actually put your bike on a really beautiful, sleek, silver, low-noise bus? And this is an unretouched photo. This is what the Orange Line looks like. I mean, isn't this idyllic? Look at the lavender. We should stop and clip some and make, you know, sachets or something. This is a public transportation line in the valley. It's kind of amazing. So the idea is that LA is going to be LA, but we're going to be sneaking in the corners, you know? And we're just going to be there a little bit. And your vista is going to change ever so slightly because, oh, look, there's a train. There's one particular view when I drive. Once in a while, when I drive down the Pasadena Freeway, I will see the train go overhead on the trestle. And it's like, I still can't quite believe it, you know. So, you know, we're going to have the beautiful light and we're going to have this city, but, you know, we're going to experience it in a kind of a different way. And I think that's very exciting. You'll all be a part of it in one way or another. You're paying for it every time you buy something, and it's what you deserve. So thank you very much. Enjoy the ride.
I have a couple of questions. All right. Having grown up in Los Angeles, and my history is much longer than yours, so I rode the red carp, although it was a very abbreviated one. Mm-hmm. I also drove as a child through freeways that were empty when there was no 405.
Mm-hmm.
And I really love Union Station and that postcard that you showed us at the beginning. And then you showed us a scene of what it will become. And I could not see the old Union
Station. That's imaginary, by the way. That's just one.
Okay, because it's really upsetting if you say the wonderful Union Station and it's totally disappeared.
Well, it's not going to disappear. I can tell you that. And it's and I'm not in charge, by the
way.
Okay,
well, that's okay. And this is maybe even the harder question.
I personally guarantee it will not disappear.
No, this is even the harder question, okay? When the red car was taken out and the tracks remained on Santa Monica Boulevard, mm-hmm. and everyone said, oh, it will make driving so much easier because we will take it away and you will have more lanes, mm-hmm. which never happened. Mm-hmm. Then, when we started to put in public transportation, and there were tracks there, mm-hmm. and there was right-of-way, mm-hmm. that all disappeared, mm-hmm. and instead more lanes appeared, and now they're going to tear up Wilshire to put in the subway.
Do you see how hard this is, people?
I was just wondering. No, I'm really in favor of public transportation.
I know, and you're complaining at the same time.
But I'm really seeing it as a big waste of money and energy and time. And it would have been so much easier and cheaper, it seems. Now, this is from someone who has lived in Los Angeles for 68 years.
I'm just the design guy. Okay. I have nothing to do with anything.
Okay, I just wanted to put it out there for you.
You know what?
Because
I don't
those
even,
of us who love L.A. and want public
I can't even go to cocktail parties anymore because this is what happens. People really, really care. And they can be complete advocates and still say, but you're taking away my parking space. I live in a con. I mean, I'm generalizing. You're the petri dish of how hard it is to accomplish what we're going to accomplish. Because I do believe that you are in favor of a city that works better, and you love Los Angeles, and you've stayed here. Transit is hard. That's actually what our motto should be. Forget Go Metro. It's just like, it's really hard. Shut up, it's really hard. Union Station is a historical landmark. It's beautiful. We're not going to mess it up. We're going to make it amazing. But high-speed rail is going to pull up fast and leave fast. And, yeah, someday, when we have the money, which we do not have right now, and, you know, it's going to become a major hub, even more so than now, because it has to, and it has to grow. But we're going to work very hard to preserve the essence of what it is, and things will grow around it in, we hope, a wonderful way. And I don't know about Santa Monica Boulevard, and thank you for coming. All right, who's next?
So I'm visiting from Oakland, and I'm a transportation planner.
Welcome. You know what? Can I stop you for a minute?
Sure.
Why don't you people like us down here in Los Angeles?
No, there's
what's the deal with the Bay Area? We love you. How come you don't love us? Oh!
I was wondering if you could talk about improving the legibility of the system.
Later, not in front of...
I've never been down here. I've never ridden the system, mm-hmm. but I've gotten around very easily all week just with this. So
you really like the map?
I love it.
All right, there you go. Good, good. I'm glad.
Okay. I spent 7 years without a car in L.A. as a big fan of what we used to call Martin T. Anderson for the MTA. Uh-huh. And two of the changes that I saw over this thing that I might be from a design perspective, one is how your work might work with the ad space now that there's so many ads on the bus inside and outside and how your department works with that. And the other is the introduction of transit TV and whether your department has anything to do with extending the branding through that new medium on the Metro lines.
Oh, paid advertising. How long do you have? You know, transit is a subsidized entity in every city, and it never pays for itself. It would, it's just not possible. If transit was going to be a profit-making thing, you wouldn't have a $4 ride. You'd have a $18 ride, and people wouldn't do it. And so one of the things that our board of directors constantly tasks us with is you need to make money any way you can. When I started 10 years ago, we didn't have much ad revenue. We had some through a contract, but all those ads that you're seeing now on buses and trains on a regular basis, we didn't have ads on the outsides of trains. Now we do. Ads in Union Station, ads on every part of our system, that actually is sort of good news because we make some money on it. It's not, we won't build a rail line, but it's pretty good money. And the good news is that so many people and people who make more money themselves and, you know, are hired more highly educated are riding Metro now, and it's now a good ad buy. And so in a weird way, we've gone from a lot of sort of ambulance chasing lawyer ads to, you know, to all the major television shows, all the movies, ads for colleges on our buses and trains, and you know, different things like that. And that's actually good news. We have nothing to do with the design of that, and we hold some of that space for ourselves. Same with Transit TV. That's an ad making. That's an ad revenue generating thing on our buses. But we do get some time every hour for our own messaging, and we get a certain number of ads on the outsides of buses and trains, and also so we have a good platform to talk to people, and it's really important because our ad budgets have been shrinking every year, and we need that space. I don't know if that answered your question.
Good enough.
All right then.
Hi. If you know, when will the Santa Monica line be open?
The Santa Monica line. Do you mean the Expo line to Santa Monica? Jody, 4 years? 2015, which is like that in Metro world. Jody, how long until the subway reaches Santa Westwood? Talk to me after November 6th, that's right. Transit is hard. You have to go through years of planning, years of public meetings. You have to meet all the particulars of the state and the federal and dot every I and spend so much money before you dig the first hole. And so that line, which is being built at a rapid pace, believe it or not, is already open to Culver City, right? And we're already, not Metro, a separate authority is building that line. We're gonna operate it when it's done. That will take another 4 years. 4 years for that extension to a rail line is like, whew, you know, the subway's gonna take longer. But we also have the Crenshaw line going in that'll go south from the Expo line and eventually hook up to the subway, and that will go through Baldwin Hills and get to the airport, and then we're gonna, one day you will get off your plane and get onto a train without having to rent a car. Believe it or not, can I say amen to that? Because how can we be a real city if you have to rent a car to go anywhere? It's ridiculous. Please don't get me started. So I think 4 years, if all goes well. But it doesn't always go.
What was the inspiration for the color palette you selected?
You know, we started with a color palette. We don't really, am I right? We just love color so much that we have the world's biggest color palette right now, actually, which is perfect because so does Los Angeles. I mean, you know, we started with, the inspiration was actually that we wanted to delineate different service. So the color palette was kind of born from the fact that we were already calling these rail lines the green line, the red line, the blue line, the gold line opened up. And then when we colored the buses, we wanted to talk about the kind of service that bus had. So we have what is called local service, which is buses that stop every, you know, two blocks or so. And instead of saying Metro Bus, we said Metro Local. It's friendly. It's your local hop on, hop off. That's how you get around town. And then Metro Rapid is rapid and red. And so we color coded the buses, and then that got us kind of going on that system. But other than delineating service on our maps where you have to have different lines of color, we give ourselves the luxury because we do it all ourselves and we make the rules and we can break the rules. We use any and every color. So we started out with color as information. We still use color as information. You need to know the difference between the purple and the red line because they use the same platforms at many stations. And so color is important, but we want to reflect the color of Los Angeles, and so we suffuse everything with color as part of our way of grabbing attention.
Hi, Michael. I'm Stephanie.
Hi, Steph.
How are you?
Fine, thank you. How are you?
I went carefree.
Love your hat.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Rode 431 Commuter Express today.
Mm-hmm.
I went carefree and car-free for 2 years on the west side. I used to say I got bodied by Blue Bus back then, became a Metro rider on the Orange Line. I meditate in the morning on that beautiful trip in downtown from Tarzana. And I'm a designer in a digital marketing department for an educational nonprofit. And we're, as I was watching the presentation, I'm just really drawn to this idea of how, you know, we've been thinking about how design can rethink the way you think, believe, and feel about something, which I really hear. Metro is cool, but you're really, at the core, it's about helping people to feel differently about the choices that they make around transportation. I was just wondering, from the work you did prior to working at Metro to now, what advice would you give, or what have you learned in the process about what, you, if anything, you do differently as a team in your design process in this sort of making these radical shifts, you know, inspiring radical shifts in people?
Wow.
Or you can just download your brain to me and I'll take it back to my team.
Well, I think what we have learned is that you just have to try any and everything. You know, the way brands are typically built is through rigorous consistency. The Coke can, you know, looks like the Coke can. It will always be red. The subtleties that are, you know, that they pay $1 million to somebody to change the Coke can are so subtle that, you know, consumers don't really even see them. But and that's the way brands are built. The airline always looks like what it looks like, and you know, the iPod has a beautiful logo on it. But public transportation isn't like that, because nobody's waiting for it, really. Or not with the fervor that my son wants the next generation of, you know, an iPod. And so it really becomes about design, as I said, as this kind of flag, this shell that we use to, you know, over here, you know, we have an idea, and you won't like it right away because you'll have to walk, you know, and you can't shave, and you're on the bus, you know, and whatever. So I think what we've probably learned, among many things, is try everything. You know, what we did, we can't do that black and white opposites campaign again. It's done. But we have to keep talking. We have to talk about something else now. So try everything, but make sure that whatever you try, you know, imparts the necessary information and is clear and respectful and a little bit engaging. And I'm a big believer in respecting our audience. I like to throw in words like fabulous and, you know, things like we've tried a lot of headlines and people say, nobody's going to understand. And I say, yes, they will. They will. Why do you think they won't, you know? So we've learned that it's always got to be fresh, and it's always got to be engaging, and it's always got to be new, because you are constantly battling. You know, when the gas prices shot up in 2000, whenever it was, our ridership grew 25%, and then the gas prices went down, and 80% of the people went back to their cars, or 70, or whatever it was. We kept 20, that's really good, right? But it's really, really hard. And so this is like the greatest, you know, design challenge. We should have our own show, really, if you think about it, you know. It's like the greatest design challenge. It's a complete oxymoron. Public transportation with great design in Los Angeles, where, you know, we killed it, we stomped it, you know, we dismantled this great system, and now we're clawing our way back. And I don't think we can do it without this kind of visual zest, you know what I mean? Because people aren't, you know, I say this all the time, nobody's waiting for us to talk to them. They're busy doing something else. So that's what design does in this particular arena.
First, I'd probably note, if memory serves me correct, the Red Line was purchased by General Motors.
Yeah, I've heard that lore. I don't know. And Bridgestone tires, or, you know, it's like there's a good conspiracy movie waiting to happen there, you know, people in dark suits late at night.
I'm originally from New York, so there's definitely a different culture in New York and a different need. But I think the real issue, and I think you actually hit the nail on the head, if you're a marketer, and you can get someone to try Pepsi who always drinks Coke, and you have this massive influx, say, because of the price of gas goes up, but then they get off once the price of gas goes down. What I think the real issue is not about, you know, bells and whistles and cute ad campaigns. Ultimately, look at that picture. If you want to get people out of their, even the cheapest cars today with their infotainment systems and their bucket seats, the reality is you have to offer them something that's comparable, because most people, you know, it's one thing to pat ourselves on the back, it's another thing to say, how are we going to get people out of even their $12,000 little Toyota, the two-seater, or their Fiat 500? The federal regulations for fuel requirements are all going up, so people's cars can get much better gas mileage. The issue is, how do you get them out of their car, number one, their entry-level BMWs, or their even their Hyundais, which are more luxurious, and how do you keep them once you get on there? And just for some numbers, it's $2.5 billion to build that rail that's going from downtown LA to Santa Monica. Two and a half, or maybe more, billion. The 405 that they're working on now, it's $100 million per mile. Why is it when we're investing, especially in possibly soon to be outdated technology, the clean, supposedly clean air buses, these natural gas, when there are other technologies on the horizon, why not take some of that money, those billions of dollars, and it's kind of like when you're selling a car, you can make a cute ad, but if the car, and General Motors found this out, if it's all about design, not so much the ad design, but the product, because it's the product you're trying to sell. Take some of that money that's going into some of these other developments and make these buses so that they're not just sort of sleek on the outside, even though most of them still look like boxes, but make it so that when you get on the inside, you're not in an environment that's cold, that's uninviting. I have friends who have come over from Eastern Europe with not a lot of money who ride the buses and then say, I don't want to ride the bus here. You need to make a place that they want to be, have things like Wi-Fi, have better, more luxurious seats. I mean, it's, to me, it's a logical thing. So what is the effort in the future? When I was a kid, Disney made it. I know, I understand, but I'm not talking about
color. You need to come and work at Metro.
Well, I'm not talking about palettes of colors, but you said about cool, and that's the key. Disney had the monorails they created like 30 or 40 years ago. They looked like future transportation, and that's what people wanted to get on. So what is the idea of making something cool that actually, once you have them, you get them on? Well, I mean, you get...
So the question is...
The question is, what are you going to do? The ridership, I think, on the buses is around 40%. What do you do to get them on and then keep them on?
Well, first of all, you don't drive by them because there are too many people on the bus. And you buy new buses whenever you can, which is what we do. We got rid of our last diesel bus a year ago. We only have clean fuel buses. We have the newest fleet in the nation, probably. We're constantly buying new vehicles. We don't design vehicles and we don't make vehicles. We can buy what's out there. We are a transit service. We don't, you know, there are lots of entities that are doing amazing things. But, you know, if you are China, you take all of your resources and you dislocate an entire village and you build rail and you make it the state-of-the-art thing and you don't ask permission to do it. It doesn't work that way here. And so the cost of everything is so much more elevated because of the way the United States functions, which is as it should be. But we have to first get people on there, and we can't, it's just like, it's like Target has the grooviest ads in the world, right? And then when you walk into the store, when it's sale time, it's like a bomb went off in there, you know what I mean? And that's called the brand gap. That is, the promise is that we're so super groovy and you can get a, you know, Isaac Mizrahi dress for 10 bucks. And then you go in and you can't find the dress or anything, and they're screaming babies and, you know, mothers screaming at their children. That's the brand gap. We have the same situation in public transportation. The bus can be fantastic. There can be a homeless person sitting next to you. They can ride. It's their bus too. You know, there can be somebody ranting. There can be no room. You can have to stand. The bus can be late. The bus operators are generally fantastic, but they can have a bad day. They're driving 8 hours in traffic. How friendly would you be? You know. So this is the brand gap. We've talked about it many times. Like, we don't control that. We have very talented people looking for the next gen of bus and the next gen of train. They're incredible. I'm like, you can't even find me in the org chart. I'm so middle management, you know, at Metro. But there are people with expertise in everything, and they're doing their best. But, you know, I'm not trying to give you a cop-out here. It's really hard. You know, a bus costs, I don't know what a bus costs, $10 million, you think? Why are you not working at my agency? You, first of all, you and that lady there should go have dinner so you can spend all your time talking about what it should be. And then you should both come work for Metro. I'm serious. I very much appreciate that passion, and you're clearly informed, but you know, it's hard. We don't design buses.
Did you find inspiration from other cities in the U.S. or in other countries and their public transportation systems? And
we do.
Kudos to any of them.
We do. For different things, two that come to mind, neither of which is New York, by the way. I'll just add. London has had an amazing branded design program for over 100 years. They created a typeface for transport for London 100 and some odd years ago. They still use it. It's gorgeous. The same roundel that says underground has been used consistently for all that time. Thank you for coming. You. It's going to start to, it's like a cocktail party. Like, oh, you're going. All right. Anyway, that's definitely, and for over 100 years, they've created beautiful art and beautiful stations, and stayed very current. They're one of the best systems. Look what happened. The Olympics went off without a hitch. It was an amazing effort, and a very branded one. So I'd say London's probably our number one hero. But there are other systems we like for different things. We very much like the Portland system, which is very young. Their rail system, amazing signage, amazing stops, all solar powered, you know, up to the minute information, great website, lots of cool tools. You know, everybody's trying something, but as far as like the kind of stuff you're seeing here, I don't want to sound, you know, full of myself, but it's not happening. It's not happening like this anywhere else. And here's how I know, truly. I think this is like my 25th talk. Do you think if we were not still the flavor that I would be standing here? You know? There isn't, I keep getting asked, and other people get asked, because we just keep doing it, and we do it all, and we do it, I think, in an interesting way. And no other city has the funding, the will, the infrastructure, the leadership, the Matts, the Mayas, the people that really say we can do this and we can do it ourselves. So we do look to other places, and we always do surveys and that sort of thing, but it's kind of like a potchkeying examples together. We're our own inspiration.
I was impressed so thoroughly by the concept and the copywriting. So you've got so many departments there between the information graphics and the signage and you know, how ubiquitous the design is, but the concepts are so wildly strong and so engaging. And I can see by listening to you, you know, that you have a wonderful sense of humor, and I'm sure that the team of people that work with you do as well.
Where are you, by the way? Can you raise your... Oh, there you are. Hi.
I'm an expat New Yorker, so I've got a real affinity for the subway system, so you won't argue that point with me. And I do see a lot of the communication and the graphics and the solid colors and the banding and some of the layouts is kind of reminiscent of some of the New York City subway systems. But mm-hmm. What really has struck me, and what you hadn't really touched on, were the engaging ideas and the concepts. And maybe you can speak a little bit to that, like chicken egg thing. I don't know whether the concept comes first and then you come up with the visual, or maybe you have a team of people and you all sit around and brainstorm and come up with a great idea to pitch the campaign. I don't know how it works with you, but I'm
it's magic.
Proprietor. Yeah, it is.
There's a special button on our computer.
It's all smoke and mirrors until somebody gets hurt. But that's my question. It's basically the concept. Can you speak a little bit about the concept?
Not straight.
The big idea?
Well, first of all, somebody said Michael's in charge of the introductions. Michael's in charge of it. It's not true. they're really, really bright people. Once we started the ball rolling, people wanted to come and work with us. There's several of them here in the audience. The concept starts with any of them. You know, Matt had the idea about problem solution, and when he said the problem is this and we're the solution, I said, hey, that's like an opposite. You know, and then we started riffing on that. We do have brainstorms. We do have several, when we're diving into something pretty big, we have several people working on it. Anybody can contribute. We have an internship program. We have people from all the design schools, or most of them. You know, the guy who did the cool aggro take one for, you know, X Games. Anything that's good, anything that's the best, will win. I will say probably the most important thing that I personally do is write. I am the worst designer in the crew, for sure. That's actually why I'm good at my job, because I think creative directors should find amazing talent and then let the ponies run. But I do tend to kind of tweak and shape that voice. And someone has to do it, and I like to do it. And if I know that I'm doing that with everything, at least I know that there is a sense of unity in the conversation. And it's one of my favorite things to do, especially when you can get away with a headline like, you know, plan your next trip, man, or, you know, something like that. So that's sort of fun, because it's like you sneak that out the door. But really what happens is that someone like you actually takes notice and feels that they are being, you know, dialogued with, as opposed to the way it used to be, you know, or it's getting better on the bus. It's not a bad thing to say, but really? Was it getting better on the bus? Yeah. Don't put something out there. Like, I won't let anybody boast. We recently had a campaign where one of the things was, it's just that easy. Somebody, one of the marketing folks had written, you know, a good bit of copy, and one of the things was, it's just that easy. And that might work for a certain kind of an ad, but for the particular thing that we were talking about, it's not easy. It has to do with the tap card and senior citizens, and it's not easy. And so I said, we can't say that, you know? We have to be truthful, first and foremost. So, thank you for picking up on that, because I think that is, you know, when you have 8,000 colors and you have new photos all the time and new art all the time, the one through line is the way we, what we call the voice, the way that we speak. And I hope that will always be there, because I think that's one of the things that's particularly personable about the authority of Metro. Thanks for coming.